I think people experience moral shame, especially because of the existence of other people who surround them.
Hi all, welcome to episode 2 of Moral Shame Talks, named Belonging Groups. And today we're going to look at moral shame and its expressions through the eyes of an MA student in sociology. Welcome Esra.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining.
Esra is a student in sociology at Radboud University, and she's interested in questions such as, where do certain inequalities and conflicts between groups of people come from? How can we avoid worsening these problems and how to solve them by using policies? With the ultimate goal that everyone in our society has the same opportunities to develop. And currently, she's writing her thesis and focuses on reintegration of welfare recipients. And I would like to start with a fragment of the Shame Talks that represent the theme of this episode. Willemijn, if you have to pick a specific garment out of your wardrobe, is there one item you feel particularly morally ashamed about, and why this one?
I actually think that I already gave the garment away, but it was a basic t-shirt from Primark. Especially with the basic t-shirts or other basic clothing items, I believe it's better to purchase them from somewhere else. You can buy them at almost any store nowadays. When I bought the t-shirt at the time, the labor circumstances of workers and information about the materials and sources that Primark used were on the news a lot.
And what role do garments play in experiencing moral shame to you?
I am under the impression that it is more brand focused, especially in secondary school. This was a real struggle for me. A lot of classmates wore brands like Tommy Hilfiger, while I had to wear C&A or Primark. And people commented on me and made fun of me because of this.
Well, I think a lot of people can relate to this fun making or commenting on their fashion choices at some point in their lives. Either in high school, at work, but perhaps even amongst friends. And even especially with fast fashion clothing. But it shows how we use clothes to distinguish ourselves from others, and together with Esra, we'll explore moral shame from a sociological perspective, as it is a social feeling, of course. We'll speak about disconnections between different groups of people through clothes, sustainability, but also through knowledge. And we're going to explore what plays an important role in moral shame. And all these subjects will revolve around the question, how can we make sense of, and what can we learn from, moral shame through the eyes of sociology?
Well, Esra, you've been interested in equality amongst groups of people. And the Shame Talks example of Willemijn and how she was made fun of because of her fast fashion clothes also creates a distinction between groups of people. And I believe it also can be used deliberately to create a distinction. And I'm curious, is this a common thing that we would like to distinguish ourselves from others? And why is it so important to us?
Well, I think that it might seem that we want to distinguish ourselves from others, but in the end, we all want to belong to a certain social group. I have an example of the work of photographer Hans Eichelboom, and he does exactly show this. He has photographed random people on the street who are all wearing the same kind of outfits, and he put all those photographs together. And it shows that everyone everyone wants to belong to a certain social group. And we may think that we are an original individual, which is not influenced by others. But in the end, we are all comparing ourselves to the people who surround us. It is true that the people who are part of this social group want to show others that they belong to this certain group. So still, it is important for people to show others that they are part of a certain group, which has a certain social status. And they do try to show that they wear the kind of clothes that belong to this certain group.
Well, I had to think of the work of the Exactitudes, and that's quite the same as the work of Hans Eichelboom, actually. Because they photograph and portray people in the same identical framework and posture. So they offer an overview of how people are striving to distinguish themselves from others by taking on a group identity. Well, it's a bit the same as the work of Hans Eichelboom, but what is funny about Eichelboom's work, I believe, is that it's really on the streets, while the Exactitudes are shot in a studio with the same white background. But it really shows a contrast between individuality and uniformity. But can we then say that by doing one thing that we want to achieve the other, so that we want to distinguish ourselves, but we're actually achieving to be part of a specific social group?
Yeah, I think you're right about that. And I guess that we all strive to a certain social identity within a certain social group. And it is possible that within that social group, you want to distinguish yourself from other social groups. But it is something that we do without thinking about it, I guess. And yeah, because he is photographing on the streets, I think that people are not aware of the fact that on the same day, there are maybe 100 people walking by with the same kind of outfit. And yeah, this is really funny, a funny thing when you see his work. I don't know, I had to laugh about it a little as well, because we might think that we are individuals, but in the end, we all look the same.
Yeah,
it's kind of funny.
Yeah, yeah, I can understand, because I saw the exactitudes then during my studies, and we all had to laugh as well, like, oh, we want to be so unique, and fashion tells us, yeah, if you buy this shirt, you can be unique, but then at the end, we're all like dressing in the same way. But I was wondering, with a sociological view, why do you think clothes are used for this? Is it because it's the first thing you see of people, or that we want to distinguish ourselves through our appearances?
I think, yeah, it's especially because, I think clothes are the easiest way to show others where you belong to. So when you buy clothes from a certain brand, which is quite expensive, you can immediately show people that you have the money to buy it, and that you belong to this group of people who have the money, who have the certain social status, who have the certain incomes, who are from the higher positions in society. And I think clothes are the easiest way to show people, yeah, to which social group you belong.
So the example of Willemijn, that while everyone wore Tommy Hilfiger and she wore fast fashion clothes, really illustrates this fact that we use brands to show others in what social group we belong.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, and then I would like to hear you a fragment from Shame Talks as well.
Okay, Sarah, so imagine you own 100 pieces in total. Would you openly tell this number to others, and how does this make you feel?
I would be ashamed to tell this, because why do I need so many items and still at the same time saying and really believing I have nothing to wear? Because I genuinely think that the actual number of the pieces show otherwise.
So this amount creates friction for you then?
Yes, because I know there are a lot of people out there that don't have all these clothes and still are happy with what they have. If I have to tell others that I own 100 pieces, I would be ashamed because it's so many.
Well, this is a question I ask in every Shame Talks. It's a question that asks, how many items do you own in your closet? And it created a lot of different reactions. And it's either because it's too many, much more than what we actually need, or either because it's too little, but it has to do with comparing to one another. And comparing also lies in the core of shame, because you always look at yourself from the perspective of the other. So you are looking at yourself through the eyes of others. But why is it so important for ourselves to compare to others, do you think?
I think that we are all comparing ourselves to the people who surround us. It's something a human does. It's just in human nature to compare yourself. And how we feel about ourselves is strongly influenced by directions other people give us. If we would be alone in the world, we would have no clue about our own identity, because your identity is shaped by the feedback from others who surround you. So in creating your own identity, your surroundings are super important. Yeah, for example, think about people who have a lot of money and possessions, but are still longing for more.
I'm wondering then, is it also that we're comparing to one another also with strangers, or is it mostly focused on indeed the people in our surroundings?
Yeah, I think it's especially the people who surround you and who are part of your own social group, because that is the group you feel connected with. So within your social group, you really strive to this positive group identity. And especially the opinions of people from your own social group affect you. And yeah, what someone you do not feel connected with thinks about you is less important than the opinions of people from your own social group?
Well, I think how we are comparing with others to be part of a group also plays an important part in how I see moral shame as a social construct. And I would like to show you the following fragment of a shame talk. Well, I see moral shame as a social construct, but what is your view on this?
Yeah, I understand, but I do also believe the people who experience this and who hear these voices are the ones who really understand the matter. Because if you say this to the people who shop at Primark, I question what the effect will be of this, because perhaps they just don't know better.
Well, in this fragment, I discussed that moral shame is a social construct, and I believe we hear a lot of voices telling us to live sustainably, either on the news, in advertisements, or even amongst group of friends when you discuss where to buy secondhand or where to buy your new clothes. But I'm curious about your view on moral shame as a social construct, and do you believe that moral shame is a social construct?
Yes, I do believe moral shame is a social construct. I think people experience moral shame especially because of the existence of other people who surround them. If something is quite important within your social group, but for you personally it may not be important, I think this friction can cause moral shame. I think especially the shame you experience because of your own social group is quite important. When you are, for example, part of a social group in which sustainability is not important at all, it's more likely that sustainability is not on the top of your head. And when everyone who is important for you is wearing fast fashion without feeling ashamed, you are likely not to feel ashamed as well. So, yeah, you are maybe not even aware that you could feel ashamed of wearing fast fashion. So I think that feeling ashamed is mostly shaped by your own social group and what is important to wear within your social group.
Yeah, interesting, because I defined this social construct as something more general, but you actually say that this social construct differs per group then. So everyone can experience, or every social group has their own social construct actually.
Yes, yeah, I do believe that social constructs can differ between different groups within society. An example is the social construct of gender. Within some social groups, gender is quite important. So on the one hand, you have those gender reveals, which really focus on the distinction between boys and girls. But on the other hand, in society, you also have groups which believe that gender should not be important and that we should not focus on the differences between being a boy or being a girl, and that it's just something we shaped ourselves, that gender is something we socially shaped and that we should not focus on gender when we give birth, for example. So in this example, you see that within society, the social construct of gender can really differ. So it does mean that social constructs are not the same for everyone.
All right. Well, I'm curious about what is important in social constructs in general, because I've read a little text about Christian Dior with his fashion designs, used a lot of fabrics just shortly after the Second World War. A lot of people in society experienced a friction because of this. And I think that also relates to social constructs. But what does social constructs actually lay bare, or what is important in a social construct?
Well, I think that a social construct is really affected by culture, time, norms, beliefs, etc. So what you said about the example of Christian Dior really shows that a social construct changes over time and that it is really fluid. So what we think is important right now can change in 20 years. And also gender, of course, the example that I already used, is also something which really differs between different countries, between different social groups, over time as well. So it is something which which changes all the time and which is also influenced by culture, by norms, beliefs, etc.
Coming back to Christian Dior, of course, at that time it was about having less, but now we're facing overproduction and having more and more and more. So I think that strengthens the idea that social constructs are fluid and changes over time. And this is also visible in the following fragment I would like to show you. And do you believe moral shame is something people experience or can experience often?
I think a lot of people experience this, especially with fast fashion. But I do believe a certain group of people experience this.
And what kind of group is that then?
I don't think people with a low income have interest and motivation for this. And even though they want to do it, it's not possible.
Well, the matter of income related to sustainability is much discussed in the Shame Talks. And I believe income also plays a crucial role in the sustainability debate. Because when people cannot manage to buy something that is sustainable in their eyes, they give price as the main reason for this. And I can imagine that this also creates a friction or conflict amongst people. But I'm curious, do you believe sustainability creates a distinction between different people right now, and how is that done?
Yeah, I definitely think that sustainability creates a distinction between people, and especially between people with higher incomes and people with lower incomes. And I can explain this by looking at post-materialism. We can say that right now we live in a post-materialistic world in which we are more wealthy than ever. Our society now is more wealthy than it was ever, which makes more space for matters such as equal rights and social and environmental sustainability. We have now more space to think about these matters because we have less financial issues. And this relates to an article of Rutger Bregman. He argues that when you have financial issues, you have less mental space. And people who have a lot of financial issues are focused on the short term. They focus on things like, okay, how can I pay my bills? And he even argues in his article that being poor can negatively influence your IQ. This is where the distinction between the rich and the poor is made.
Well, this distinction between the higher and lower incomes and the feeling of moral shame is really relevant, I believe. But something else that was much discussed in my research method is illustrated by the following fragment.
So, I believe a lot of people are not aware of the process. I think that a lot of people are not occupied with sustainability and that the process that lies behind the creation and production of a garment is not always clear. So fast fashion is something that a lot of people know about, but at the same time, a lot of people don't know what it contains and what the workings are.
This fragment shows that knowledge about how the fashion industry operates or the lack of knowledge has a part of moral shame. This knowledge is also something that isn't educated on schools, at least when I was younger, and we can question whether the information provided by brands is reliable, for example. But this knowledge the participants have regarding the fashion industry are related to their own values and views on the world. And this is what makes it interesting in my view, as they also have different values regarding sustainability. But I'm wondering, what is important here?
Well, the matter you are describing is also described as cultural capital. This is an idea of Bourdieu. Bourdieu and his idea of different sorts of capital are often used within the sociology. The idea of cultural capital is that we grow up in a certain neighborhood and that your parents have certain beliefs and certain norms and that you are influenced by this. And for example, also cultural goods are a part of this cultural capital. Think about things such as music instruments and books. These goods can help you creating a certain distinctive cultural identity. By playing an instrument and reading books, you can show others that you belong to the high culture group. And I think that knowledge about sustainability can also be a certain form of cultural capital. If you are sustainable, you can show others that you belong to the group that is aware of the matters around sustainability. And right now it is a trending thing among the people with a higher socioeconomic status to be sustainable.
Yeah, interesting, because I've read an article with the title "The New Elite." You can recognize them as they do yoga, listen to podcasts, and drink oat milk. I really had to laugh at the title because, yeah, it really shows to me the matter you said, like the people with a higher economic status are more occupied with these kind of things. But when I spoke of knowledge with the participants, I noticed that everyone would love to receive some more information on fashion, sustainable fashion, what the production is of clothes, so much more, yeah, what's going on behind the garment. But they wouldn't look actively for it, but rather receive it from people out of their surroundings. And I'm curious, do you believe there's a specific reason for this?
Well, I do think that people have an idea of what the fashion industry looks like and that it's very pollutive and that there are a lot of people working in the fashion industry which are harmed. But it is just in the back of their minds. They know that what they would read when they look it up is something negative, something they might not want to know. And this is sort of a denial of the situation. When I do not read it, I do not feel it, and I do not have to feel guilty by making choices which maintain how the fashion industry operates at the moment.
So that really seems indeed like a denial. If I don't know it's there, it's just not there. And before we talked about the distinction between certain people with knowledge and certain people who don't have this knowledge, but how can we make sure that everyone has the same knowledge actually?
Well, what I said before is that people need mental space to get certain knowledge. And I believe that education does not really work when people have short-term priorities. So I think that first of all, you need to tackle the problems of scarcity. And yeah, this is also what you see when you look at post-materialism, which we discussed before. When people have more than enough money for their basic needs, they will start to care about other matters, such as the environment. So when you create more mental space, when you make sure people have enough money, education will work. And otherwise, they do not have the mental space, so education will not be effective, I think.
I believe a lot of people, especially within the fashion industry or within the sustainable discourse, think that educating people is really important, but they don't take this matter into consideration, actually. So we just are educating people, but then if they don't have the mental space for it, yeah, how effective is that? But on the other hand, I also believe educating is still important on sustainability because, yeah, we're not educated at all on these matters. We don't have classes on sustainable production or what sustainability actually means. But how can we educate people from your point of view? What plays an important role in educating? And is there a specific group, for example, that we should educate?
Well, the education I talked about before was more educating adults. Yeah, exactly. But I think that in primary school, you can already, and in secondary school, you can really make a difference. And I think you should start at primary school by educating children about sustainability. Children learn quite fast and they take this knowledge home to their parents. I even remember learning in primary school about the use of water, and the teacher really tried to visualize the amount of water we use in a day. And by visualizing something, things get more real. And this also helps us to remember it for a longer period of time. And I have another example of the refugee crisis. It's an example of why framing and visualizing is quite important. The refugee crisis is really framed as a flow of anonymous people, And from the moment these people become your neighbors, they become recognizable and you see someone is actually a human like you and has the same kind of interests and the same kind of needs as yourself. So you often see that people's opinions towards refugees can change from the moment these refugees get a face and are not anonymous anymore. So visualizing something can really help in understanding something.
And I also believe that visualizing is really important indeed, because you hear a lot of like academical researches and those findings are really truly amazing and very interesting, but then it just isn't brought to the broader audience. And I believe their diffusion can be made between arts and more academical research to help each other move forward. Well, during our conversation, the distinction and equality through fashion and sustainability, of course, make sure that it's not accessible for everyone. And it's covered in all of our questions and answers. But I'm also wondering, what could be a solution towards this distinction, do you think? And what is important in making it accessible for everyone, in your view?
I think policy can play a big role in here. By using subsidies, governments can make sure that sustainable options are cheaper, which makes them more accessible for the lower incomes. And in the end, the polluter should pay. But currently, we see this is not happening. So the products which cause a lot of pollution should be more expensive. And I guess that's the only way in which we can solve this problem and in which we can make sustainable choices accessible for everyone.
As someone said to me once, like, oh, I think it's really quite weird that the products that are very harmful for humans, that are very harmful for the environment, very harmful for the workers who make our products, that those products are way more cheaper. And that was also something that made me think, like, yeah, it's really weird that we, reward actually the polluter. Like, they don't pay for the pollution themselves, but we even reward them for this pollution. Yeah, and that is quite interesting, I believe. And I hope, of course, the policies and subsidies really can create change. Well, that leads to the last thing, actually. And I've read a book of Jennifer Jacquet, and she believes that the rich can buy their way out of environmental guilt. So they can buy sustainable products and don't feel bad about it anymore, because they can tell themselves, I'm behaving well.
Yeah, I've read a book of Rutger Bregman, and he talks about shame as well. And according to him, human beings are the only creatures who can experience shame, which is quite interesting, because shame is unique for our species. And shame can help us behave ourselves. It actually controls our behavior. It does make sure that we do not harm others and that we do not want to put others in a difficult position. Because when you harm someone, you would feel ashamed of your own behavior. And that is why you do not do it, and to keep your behavior under control. And I think that is why some people would buy their way out of guilt, what you talked about before. They know they did something which harms others. They feel ashamed of it. And by buying one product which is sustainable, they can feel better and they do not feel ashamed anymore. So this is really a way in which we try to get rid of our guilt.
Yeah, interesting, because that also relates then to the fact that we won't look for information about the fashion industry ourselves, because once we know that information, or once we have that information, we at the same time know we did harmful things to others.
Yeah, I think that is the core. Once we know what is happening in those fabrics where people are working for our clothes in very bad circumstances, we feel guilty. And yeah, of course, people do not want to feel guilty, because shame is something we do not want to experience. So when we do not know it, we do not feel ashamed. And yeah, I think that is the core. I was wondering, because we just discussed that the government can play a role within the whole sustainability debate and can maybe provide that we make better, more sustainable choices. But do you think fashion industry also plays a role within this matter?
Yeah, I think they play a role, but it's quite a complex role, I believe. They have other priorities than us or other priorities than the government. So that is also something I've always felt struggling with. Like, I really enjoy fashion at one hand because I can really enjoy addressing the deeper layer of fashion. But on the other hand, I'm really frustrated with how the industry works and how pollutive it is and how discriminating it is. So about their role in bringing change, I'm really skeptic, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. And how do you feel about those shops like Zara, H&M, which is changing their whole collection every, 3 weeks? Is that something which we should ban?
I think it should change because it also is related to the way we approach the new in fashion, because we constantly want new things. We want to get this rush of buying a new product. And with this focus on the new, the speed is going faster than ever before. And also the workers, of course, in the factories have to produce even more than before. Especially during the lockdown, this really became such a big thing because people started walking to the city with closed shops, of course, but Zara was completely empty. And everyone was like, what is going on there? And I just told them, like, yeah, the collections they had in their stores weren't relevant anymore because they change every 2-3 weeks. So it was quite a shock for everyone to see an empty store. And at the same time, that was also a really nice approach because it really created a shock with consumers.
Yeah, quite interesting. This is, I think, a thing we should discuss more in general, to think about things like, okay, is it normal to change a collection every few weeks, or can we also deal with only a spring, summer, fall, winter collection, which is still new clothes every season.
Yeah.
So every 3 weeks might not be that important, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, definitely my opinion as well. Well, with this, I would like to wrap up the episodes. And we started this episode with the question, how can we make sense of and what can we learn from moral shame through the eyes of sociology? Well, it shows how clothes are used to distinguish ourselves from other social groups in order for us to be part of the group we want to belong to. We compare ourselves to one another in order to be part of our group, as we want feedback from others, but also to control our behavior. This is important in the experience of moral shame, as it's quite a privileged feeling that a certain layer in society is experiencing at the moment, as they have the resources and mental space to be occupied with this. Thank you, Esra, for joining and your interesting insights and perspectives from a sociologist's point of view.
Thank you, you're welcome.